Good afternoon, everybody. Good afternoon, everybody. Everybody didn't reply. Good afternoon. I'm still a teacher at heart, so call and response is important to me. Thank you so much for bringing me and having me here, Dr. Matthew and Dr. Ireland. I'm really delighted to be here in part because a little over 3 years ago, spring 2012, I would take writing retreats to Madison as I was finishing my PhD at the University of Illinois Chicago. And part of the way that I got through my dissertation would be to go visit my friends at local places, maybe 2 or 3 hours away. I would write for 9 hours and I would hang out with them at night. And I did that in Madison about 4 times I came up here. So it's really cool to come and share a little bit with you about the stuff I was thinking about when I was here and to kind of show you where that work has gone and to kind of walk you a little bit through the trajectory of that intellectual work that I really did a lot of it here. So again, my name is Chezare. I'm from Chicago, born and raised. I went to the University of Illinois, ILL. Okay, might be the only one, okay. I was a Chicago Public School math teacher and school administrator. I was a math coach in a couple of turnaround schools in Chicago. Anybody from Chicago or taught in Chicago? Okay. You're the coolest people in the room. Okay, just kidding. All right, my research interests really look broadly at schooling conditions that support high academic outcomes for students of color, particularly black male students. And I have looked at that work and got at that work by studying student-teacher interactions, specifically trying to get my mind around empathy as a tool for improving the ways in which teachers communicate across racial and cultural difference. And to just tell you a little bit about how I got there, when I started graduate school, I worked throughout my entire graduate program. I was teaching eighth grade, and I was working with who I thought were very committed, hardworking folks on the south side of Chicago. And I read this work in a critical race theory course about empathy and this concept of false empathy, which is basically when we think of ourselves as more empathetic than we really are, or that we can really demonstrate because we walk into a relationship with an agenda around what it is that we want to do in terms of helping someone without actually negotiating help from the perspective of the person whom we're trying to help. And I thought to myself, could that be the missing link, in particular for the white female teachers who I worked with, who I thought really had good intentions, but really had a difficult time building substantive relationships with students of color and black male students. And that's what brought me to that, to this work. So today I'm presenting a paper that I am actually just finished writing. And just trying to think about these ideas, particularly now in the context of a teacher education program, a question that I get a lot is, can we teach people to empathize? Is empathy a thing that we can actually use? And so I want to get into that a little bit. So just by way of an agenda, what I'm hoping to get through without rushing, but I want to talk a little bit about what I've learned in previous work, how I see empathy specifically now as a professional teaching disposition, particularly as a disposition of culturally responsive pedagogy, and cultivating dispositions now for culturally responsive pedagogy. In a teacher education program, when we think about teacher learning and what we can do to support how well folks are prepared to utilize empathy as a professional tool, that's where my work is headed. So I want to preface this talk in a couple ways. One, this work is not about building a more empathetic teacher workforce. I'm not very interested in whether or not someone is empathetic, in part because it's really hard to look at someone and say, you're empathetic and you're not. There are too many variables that one has to negotiate to be able to make such assessments, and I'm not a psychologist. So that is not something I want to do, but there is this sense that empathy can be utilized as a tool. So the same ways teachers are prepared to write lesson plans and to utilize the best literacy practices, I'm wondering, particularly in this broader project of rehumanizing teaching and learning and moving away despite this climate of high stakes testing and accountability and the privatization of public education, whether or not empathy can really be negotiated professionally as a tool when applied to interactions with youth of color. This work is also anchored in the professional practice of teachers, folks who are out, who are in classrooms, who are working. And that's important because far too much work theorizes about teachers without really including teachers' voices. And also, when you think about white female teachers, which is where I started, there are these popular sort of mainstream depictions of white women that are deficit-based. And I was really interested in finding white women who were actually very effective at what they did with black male students, and really thinking about how empathy as a tool could be useful across the range of difference that these women brought to the table. So that's sort of where my work picks up. And finally, this work is undergirded by philosophical assumptions rooted and heavily influenced by critical race theory. So for example, part of my belief system in the way that I sort of see my work epistemologically is that race and racism is permanent, it's everywhere. If you turn to the left, you turn to the right, you can find some examples. And that race heavily influences then the teaching and learning process. And that's an important sense because empathy is very personal, and the ways that it's expressed and applied in social interactions is mediated by our racialized points of view. And that's really significant when you think about how we utilize and negotiate empathy in practice. So when I, as a graduate student, read that work and I got really excited about empathy, I knew first, what do? You start reading a bunch of stuff, right? And I got into the education literature and found that there wasn't a lot of empirical work that people had done around this concept of empathy and operationalizing empathy. Most of what the mentions in education and multicultural education in particular are marginal. So it's folks who study effective teachers and they say, well, this teacher shared stories that parallel the experiences of their students. That's empathy and we need more empathy. So scholars are endorsing empathy for building strategic relationships, maintaining high academic expectations for students, establishing positive and productive partnerships with families, and acquiring professionally informed social and cultural perspectives of students, their families, and their communities. But again, I was hard-pressed to find any work that really looked at, particularly when you talk about racial and ethnic difference, not just empathy broadly, but in a multicultural classroom settings, how do people of color, or how do teachers utilize empathy as a tool, and what does it look like? When we say teacher empathy, what comes to mind? And in order for me to get my mind wrapped around that, I actually had to go to literature outside of education. And I think because education is an applied field, it's really important that all of us education scholars find ways to go and look at work that's outside of our discipline. And so I settled on the concept of empathy out of social psychology that really puts forward empathy as both emotional and intellectual. And I use the work of Mark Davis. And when you think about the emotional side of things, we call it empathic concern. It's a tendency to experience feelings of sympathy and compassion for unfortunate others. We also refer to this as sympathy. So it's really sort of rooted in affect and our affective responses to one's circumstances. Then there's the intellectual dimension, which is perspective taking, which is the tendency to spontaneously adopt the psychological point of view of others in everyday life. So it's my capacity to see things as you're seeing them and then to respond based on my understanding and interpretation of your circumstance as you would respond if you were in a position to respond. That makes sense. So these two sort of dimensions, and there's been a lot of disagreement about whether it's emotional or whether it's intellectual, but in recent years, folks have started to settle that it's a combination of both. But that intellectual, the perspective-taking part sort of undergirds the empathic concern part. So it's hard for me to feel what you feel without at some point trying to imagine cognitively what it is that you're experiencing. And as a person who is an education researcher, I'm always very interested in how is this applicable? What does this look like in practice? And to be able to get at that, this is where teaching dispositions is important because I need to see what is it that teachers are doing. And the sort of an assumption going into the work was that if I'm studying effective teachers who are demonstrating evidence of culturally responsive pedagogy in their work, then they likely are drawing on aspects and dimensions of empathy, but they're not able to name it as such. So partly in doing this work, as you'll see, in naming this concept of empathy and the mechanism and processes sort of engaged in applying empathy in social interactions, it's a way to name what good teachers are already doing. Good teachers who are culturally responsive don't necessarily call themselves culturally responsive, they call themselves doing their job, right? And that's really important. But this concept of perspective taking, when you think about how empathy sort of moving from the abstract and the theoretical into the practical and pragmatic, perspective taking is a concept that'll come up a few times. So I'll start with a few questions that kind of has guided my thinking and my development in this work. So the first question I thought to ask in trying to get at this concept of empathy is, how do people even conceive of empathy, particularly folks who are early career teachers? What do they think it is, and how do they think that it's relevant to their work, and how do they apply it in practice? And I did a study of early career teachers in Chicago and asked them these questions, and then I interviewed their colleagues to get a sense of what their colleagues' perspectives and perceptions of their work. So one thing that came out was that teachers' conceptions of empathy tend to change when you consider empathy in a professional teaching context. So if you ask someone what's empathy, they'll come up and they'll probably say it's being in someone else's shoes, it's feeling what someone else feels. But when you ask them what that looks like in practice, a couple of things that I would hear is, well, I'm empathetic, but I'm no nonsense. These kids have to do their work, right? So when you change the context of empathy's application, it actually changes the definition and the conception of the term. Teachers' beliefs about empathy's importance and relevance to their practice with students and family of color tend to be inconsistent with the reality of its application. So sometimes we have illusions of grandeur, right? And we think we're doing something, but when we ask the people who are closest to us if we're doing what it is that we think we're doing, there are going to be lots of inconsistencies. And what was interesting is that I would have a conversation with these women, and then I would ask the people that they recommended knew their teaching the best. And there would be reliability amongst the three people who would say, no, they actually think that they're fixing kids. Now, they might call it something else, but this is what they're really doing, and that was interesting. So it was a lot of inconsistency between what they thought and what they did. And their conceptions of empathy tend to be intuitive and largely shaped by personal experience rather than formal learning. How many people have gone through a teacher education program somewhere in elementary? Did you all ever talk about empathy? I know I didn't. We didn't talk about empathy in my program. So most folks sort of take their concept of empathy just based on life experience, right? No formal training, and a lot of teachers, we teach the way that we were taught. So if no one really raises the issue, we don't really have much to say about it other than what we think we already know about it. But the teachers who participated in this pilot study and the dissertation study at the end said, you know, you really got me thinking about some stuff that I've never really thought about. And it then kind of changes then the way that they think about themselves in relationship to their students, which then sort of has some implications for their actual practice. So in asking the question of one's conceptions of empathy, naturally I wanted to know more about then how is empathy actually enacted in a classroom. And this work really takes the work of Davis in the framework that I described earlier in studying student-teacher interactions and looking really close at the affective dimensions and the intellectual dimensions through a series of observations and interviews. And I can talk more about methodology in the question and answer if you have questions. But this is some work you can find to get methodology. But I find that perspective-taking and empathic concern look very different for every teacher. There are a few different variables that immediately sort of come to mind in terms of one's application of empathy and its actual enactment. Personality is really important. Whether you conceive of yourself as more emotional or whether you conceive of yourself as more sort of asocial and not really touchy-feely, all of these, and personal experience, how much experience you have in that community with that group of kids, all impact your capacity to be a perspective taker and to demonstrate empathic concern. Perspective taking and empathic concern are also impacted by social and contextual variables such as prior knowledge, relationship to, and experience with students, which is what I was just saying. And then student outcomes and feedback are primary indicators for assessing the effectiveness of one's application of empathy. So part of my doing this work was really trying to get a sense of what is a process. Is there an instructive model that can come from the work of these effective teachers that can be constructed through the lens of empathy? And what I found is that student feedback and the capacity of a teacher to be very keenly aware of how his or her actions impacted a student and then the student's reaction to that person's sort of decision making in the interaction was really important, because the feedback that student projects, so for example, I asked you to sit down. Did the student actually sit down? Did the student throw a tantrum? Did the student walk out of the classroom? What happened? And being able to use that as evidence for how I need to negotiate subsequent interactions could be classified as an act of perspective taking. So it's this cyclical model that I talk about in the Urban Review piece. So finally, in writing my dissertation, for example, you know, you ask a question, but then the question is so big that you have to answer a whole bunch of other questions before you can actually answer the question that you hope to answer. I wanted to know what the benefits of empathy were, but it was really hard for me to get to the benefits without asking questions about one's conception and the application of empathy. But in finally sort of getting to this concept of empathy's benefits, what I found across the teachers and the two studies that I'm sort of pulling from here is that those teachers were willing to engage in a lot of risk-taking. So for example, there might be a kid in my class who I know, if I allow him to listen to music, now that's against a school rule, but if I allow this student to listen to music during guided practice, it's likely that he's gonna be much more productive in this class, right? And that's a risk because as an administrator, if the administrator comes in and it's a kid listening to music, what am I gonna think about you and your teaching, right? And there's this article that I wrote about this concept of family business. And so a teacher would, every morning of every day of the school year, she would invite the kids in and she would say, who has family business? And it was an opportunity for the students to just tell stories. They would talk about what they were buying for prom. They would talk about family outings. They would talk about any number of things, who they're dating, right? Gossip in the school. And she would take as much time or as little time as those kids. It was student directed. So one time I was there, family business went 30 minutes in a 55 minute classroom. Now those of us who are instructional leaders or who have done instructional leadership, you can't justify giving 35 minutes to just students talking about what they want to talk about in a classroom. And when I asked her, well, how do you justify this to your administrators? She said, well, if I don't give them this space to talk, then they're going to be thinking about this and not the lesson. And it sort of balances itself out because sometimes nobody has any family business, so they just move on. And there is a sense that we still have objective and expectations. So we can take this 30 minutes, but I'm still planning to get through this content, right? And that was something that she negotiated. But there's a lot of risk-taking and flexibility across these folks' work. And undergirding this risk-taking and flexibility, which makes a lot of sense, if you are demonstrating evidence of empathy, it's also likely that you have strong classroom community, that you have trusting relationships with students, and the classroom and community and trusting relationships sort of hints at the types of personal adaptations that you make as a teacher. So for example, one of my teachers said, I am not someone who likes to hug or do a lot of the fuddy-duddy, you know, I cringe when I see my colleagues giving kids high fives, I really don't want kids to touch me. But she said, there's this one kid, if I don't give him a hug, he's not gonna have a good day. So I'm gonna make this personal adjustment to ensure that this kid is having a good day. And it's really uncomfortable for her to do that, but she recognizes I gotta be flexible, right? And so that's the sort of the trusting relationships in the classroom community. The other piece is finding proactive interventions. So really, again, being keen to student feedback and learning how to make professional adaptations. So it's not changing the expectation, but it's changing the process by which students meet expectations. So for example, another teacher had a student in her class who was sleeping every day. He was just coming in classes, and she found herself getting really frustrated, and then a light bulb went off. She said, maybe I should just pull him to the side and ask him what's going on. So that's fairly intuitive, but we don't always think about that because of all the competing demands, right, as a teacher. She took a little time, and she found out, oh, he's working overnight, he's taking care of his brothers and sisters. And so she said, well, you're gonna sleep in class and you're gonna get a failing grade. There's no way to negotiate that. But I can advocate for you and find you a space in the night program so that you can come and get this credit because you're just gonna get an F in class, right? So she found a way to respond without lowering the expectation. And when people think about empathy, in many ways, they sort of think of empathy as lowering the expectations. It's me feeling sorry for students. And really, this concept of perspective taking that I'll get to in just a second here is not about feeling sorry, but it's really about understanding a set of conditions and really thinking strategically about how to respond to those conditions. So as I start to think now really deeply about teacher education, I was trained as a social foundation scholar. And so I was a teacher, and my background is working in schools. But it's been recently now that I'm in conversations in my department about How do we do this work? And again, thinking about critical race theory and the significance of that for me, undergirding this is that we can't talk about cultural responsiveness if we're not talking about race and ethnicity. If we're not talking very critically about the ways that white supremacy structures schooling experiences for kids and the ways that we reproduce inequity and how we even arrange our work, right? And it's very easy to call myself culturally responsive because I integrated a few different characters in an example without really actually understanding the group of students that are sitting in front of me, right? And so empathy sort of turns out, from my estimation, to be sort of the glue between my own conception of culture and race. Even as a black man teaching all black kids, this is an issue that I faced, right? Because there's difference regardless of if you share the race and gender of the students that's sitting in front of you. There's generational differences, there are moral differences, right? And how I think about and view the world, that's significant as a teacher that I find a way to learn how to communicate and respond in ways that are culturally congruent, right? And appropriate to make interpretations that most line up and translate in ways that students would understand and appreciate. So when I think about empathy, I'm thinking about the concept of perspective taking, sort of combined with this concept of teaching dispositions, which the way I'm thinking about teacher dispositions is the pedagogical knowledge and content knowledge, professional skills and beliefs that kind of work together, that intersect to inform the how I negotiate classroom interactions and the professional decisions that I make. So when you think about using empathy as a way to get inside the life worlds of the students of color that you're working with, it's finding out knowledge and reorienting and re-sort of thinking my beliefs about students' cultural difference that then hopefully translate to evidence of culturally responsive pedagogy. So for the folks that I've been studying, these teachers that have been identified, and I use a community sampling approach that's very similar to what Glory Lassen-Billings did in her study in Dreamkeeper. So I asked students and I asked administrators, who are the teachers in your building who are doing this work well, right? So these are folks who are very well respected. And what you see across these folks is that they have learned to rethink and reorient themselves around what is this kind, where am I teaching? How does where I teach matter for the types of decisions that I make with kids, right? And they're taking that type of knowledge into consideration when they are making judgments or decisions about how to negotiate interactions with students. So as I said, dispositions represent the cluster of behaviors or habits resulting from the interaction of knowledge, beliefs, and skills. And as I've been thinking much more about dispositions, the literature sort of looks at dispositions not at the root level, but what are the habits? What are teachers actually naturally doing? What's your natural inclination? And kind of looking at the cluster of behaviors as a way to start to determine what's one's knowledge, beliefs, and skills. But what it doesn't really account for is not just pedagogical and content knowledge, but really the knowledge of cultural difference, the knowledge of social, cultural, and political context as important for shaping one's beliefs, and then the skills that I develop, not just to teach a content area, but to deliver that content in a way that is culturally appropriate. So if you think about learning styles and what are the learning preferences for students of color and how that differs from what is your natural inclination for your teaching style, there are lots of personal and professional adaptations you have to make to sort of respond in a way that's culturally appropriate. So perspective taking is likely to help shift teacher beliefs about cultural difference. It supports the acquisition of new knowledge about students' home lives, and it helps teachers to develop skills needed to translate instructional content experiences into culturally affirming, relevant, and engaging classroom learning experiences. So when you think about perspective taking and what that looks like in practice, many of you who have taught or who have watched teachers, you engage in this process of perspective taking all the time. And we do it with our loved ones. It's our capacity to really sort of get inside of their thought process, right? But part of this work is we can't judge and make sense of what we've done in terms of an empathetic application without getting some feedback that what we did actually delivered the intended outcome, right? So the way that I saw perspective taking in this study was really through some teachers had writing activities where they would respond and they would go back and forth through like a journal exercise, for example, or the family business. A lot of this, at least three of the teachers did work where they would sit and have conversations deep conversations with students. And it was a routine thing. It was something that they regularly engaged in. And they would use the knowledge that they got from that type of engagement to really adjust and really change the types of decisions that they were making. And in many ways, when you think about teachers, they have power disproportionate to students, right? We're making decisions about students' lives in a classroom. And they really had to learn how to surrender that power and give up some of that autonomy so that they can make the types of adjustments that led to more favorable outcomes for students of color. So now when I'm thinking about why empathy is important and why now, folks have, again, as I mentioned earlier, made marginal mentions to empathy significance for producing culturally responsive learning experiences for students. But we want to dig in further to see what sorts of things we can do in teacher education and teacher professional development that really gets at this concept of perspective taking and giving teachers the opportunity to actually practice that skill. Because that's a skill, regardless of wherever you go in terms of schooling context, that will be useful to you in learning how to do your work. So one of the things, there's a famous article by McAllister and Irvine where they take a group of practicing teachers into communities that are culturally different from their own culture. And they don't just go into those communities on the bus, right? Sort of seeing everybody, oh, look at this. But they spend days, weeks going to the places of worship, really spending time with families, learning how to cook certain meals, right? And Lisa Delpit talks about it in her book, Mathematics is for White People. What if all of the teachers that from Teach for America who took the jobs of the black educators in New Orleans, what if they first had to spend a year apprenticing with those black teachers before they took those jobs, right? What types of skills, what types of perspectives would they develop about their work that would then impact their beliefs and the skills that they had to go and be in those communities and be a viable sort of partner with those communities, right? So when I talk about cultural immersion experiences, I'm talking about really deep, rich experiences that force all of us to be subordinate and to become minoritized in communities where we're not the majority. Critical self-reflection. I did a lot of self-reflection in my elementary education program. Why did my lesson work? Why didn't it work? Nobody ever asked me to say, how does my race implicated in the decision that I made, right? Empathy is deeply personal. So in order for me to really get into this concept of perspective taking, why aren't we asking teachers whether or not they like themselves? Anybody here taught middle school? Anybody who taught middle school knows if you don't like yourself, the students will let you know, right? You got low self-esteem, you're going to know about it because they are going to find everything about you that you are insecure about, right? But we never really take time and have conversations with teachers about how do you come to know yourself, right? How do you know what ticks you off or what makes you happy or what frustrates you? Where does that knowledge come from? There's no real deep critical self-reflection. And I'm thinking about how can I partner with my colleagues in psychology to really develop some courses that force people to deal with bias in ways that's not superficial, where we just take the implicit bias test and then that's sort of a unit that we move on, right? But to really dig into where and how our prejudices develop over time and how our beliefs really impact the types of decisions we make. I see that as really deeply important and not just happening in the one diversity course you take, but that it be a theme that flows throughout the curriculum across content areas. And then exposure to literature and research that indexes themes of race and equity and the experiential knowledge of culturally diverse persons. It's interesting the volume of work we have about black males that does not actually include the voices of black males. And it seems, it's a little weird when you think about it. I want to know how can I work with black male students, but I never actually ask them what's important to you, what do you value, what do you see as legitimate knowledge, right, in this particular space. So, and I'm thinking about this as, in terms of perspective taking, anybody familiar with James Anderson's work? He's a historian of education. He wrote this great book called Education of Blacks in the South that talks about when slavery ended, how black folks started their own schools, and as a result, the industry, the agriculture industry took a hit, and then the folks responded with public mass schooling. So that the white women rushed into the South to civilize the black people who had already civilized themselves in their own schools. Now, what would that have done to my preparation to teach on the west side of Chicago had I read that prior to teaching on the west side, right? When I knew I was going to teach all black students, had I knew that history about black folks in this country, that would have changed sort of the deficit perspectives that I held about these students, right? Because going into that building, there was all this language around, these students are at risk, they're low income, they need this support. I was teaching eighth grade, self-contained, and my principal said, I need you to do the alphabet every day. In eighth grade, we need to say A, B, C, D, E, F, G, right? That's a problem. So I'm thinking about this in terms of how do we expose folks to critical literature in math ed, in science ed, in literacy. There are folks who are writing about race and ethnicity explicitly, but their work doesn't show up in our methods courses. And why not, right? So in terms of, again, perspective taking and sort of getting at this issue of culturally responsive pedagogy as a broad brand name, we have to deal with racial and cultural difference at a very critical level to sort of bolster people towards being able to demonstrate evidence of culturally responsive pedagogy. Okay.
What do you suggest as the base of reference for this last point that you came out? Where do teachers go for to educate themselves about that? What are the resources that teachers go
for? Where do teachers go to educate themselves about race, issues of race and equity?
This last point that he made, I'm asking, where does he suggest teachers go to find references regarding that?
I know that one of the big challenges to this point is that our colleagues are not necessarily trained in the areas of race and equity. So they don't know to bring this stuff into their classrooms. But I think that when you know better, you have to do better. So as folks are raising this issue, and there have been folks who've been raising this issue around we need race and equity as a central sort of component in teacher education for a long time, a Google search will give you, right, scholars. So for example, if you're a person in math ed and you really want to know more about math ed, you might find your colleagues who do anything on race and math ed near or far, but then you might also, because they're going to be able to direct you to folks' work, but also in this age, I feel as if in some ways, this might be a little presumptive, but you can go to Scholar Google, put in a couple search terms, and get some work, and just educate yourself, and then slowly find ways to ask questions. I think it's important in talking to teachers, you will have teachers say, well, I just want my kids to be successful. I do what I do as a teacher because I want them to be successful. And my question to them is, what is your conception of success, and how closely aligned is it with the students that you're working with? Because what we tend to do is to project onto students success based on our own notions of success that is likely linked to some racist, white supremacist sort of notion of good, right? Good schooling or good work, right? And so I think educating ourselves and just learning to ask ourselves hard questions and being able to integrate those types of questions into our content area is critically important. And so our own best resources are right here in the intellectual community. I think that sometimes part of being uncomfortable as a teacher, we're trained as experts. You have to know all the answers, right? When I graduated from my PhD program, I said, I can't get a PhD and not know something and be really smart. People are gonna expect me to know something. And teachers are trained the same way. Be a good classroom manager. If you're going to work in an urban setting, you need to be able to answer questions about how to manage a classroom. But why don't those questions ever include, do I know how to negotiate meaningful human interaction? Right? What are your relationships like with your friends and family? Would they say that you're a person that's reliable? Right? So I'm kind of going off the way. But I think you can find what you need in the intellectual community. A question? Yes.
It seems, as you described, to be somewhat open-ended and negotiable, and the way that you as a teacher are teaching and how it's being received by the students, it's all sort of fluid. Their needs change, the interactions build off of one another. I don't know if that's sort of, that's what I'm getting out of your talk.
Mm-hmm.
So one, is that accurate or not? And then two, if it is accurate, how, and you sort of wove it through your examples, how do you wed that fluidity and that open-endedness with learning goals that are mm-hmm. somewhat concrete?
Right.
So
when it comes down to it, right, outcomes are what's, and what we're all going to be looking at the outcomes. And we talk about culturally responsive pedagogy, there are indicators, academic success being one of them. And for these teachers, they were able to point to outcomes. So when I say that this teacher allowed this student to wear his headphones, he could only wear his headphones because there's a sense where you're co-constructing and co-negotiating what's appropriate and what the expectations are. So I'm conceding as a teacher by letting you wear headphones, and I'm taking a risk by responding to the rest of my students who are not happy that you get to wear headphones. But I know that for you, that is an anchor point for then you to be more productive. And because the evidence of your productivity exists in my class, I know how to go advocate for you with the rest of the teachers in the building who are constructing you as a problem and a troublemaker. And we have this issue, particularly when you think about black males. I interviewed a group of black males who were in eighth grade in a school, and they had been in that school since kindergarten. And they were telling me that I know teachers treat me based on what I did as a kindergartner and a first grader. So what happens is these stories and these constructions create a picture and a perspective that filters then what that kid is doing in terms of my interpretation of that behavior. So to get to your point, it is fluid, but any effective teacher, including the ones in my study, will likely tell you that part of their persistence was tied to their willingness and the decision to engage in this trial and error. So I'm going to try something. Oh, that didn't work. Let me try something else. I'm going to try this. Oh, that didn't work. Let me try something else. And you go through that cycle, and you might get beat up a few times or 100, 20, 200 times in that cycle. But eventually, you find what works because you want to get to the outcome, right? And so that's where the student feedback piece becomes important, particularly in talking about this in the professional teaching context, because you get that question. Like, this seems too touchy-feely, empathy and care. What is, you know, how does that translate to whether or not a student has mastered something? Well, we are actually looking at the outcome, the feedback that a student provides, and then my interpretation of the feedback has to be such that I have to know this student intimately from multiple perspectives in order to even have the capacity to interpret the feedback in an appropriate way, right? So it's a constant sort of learning cycle. The last point that I'll make to that is folks will hear this talk and say, this just seems completely overwhelming. And there's this work that talks about teachers who have tried to grapple with culturally responsive teaching and sort of thinking about culturally responsive teaching as Herculean. Like, who has time to do all of this stuff? But the one thing that we should note is that not all kids will need the same degree of effort. So in terms of your strategy, you are investing as much effort as necessary for kids, but not all the kids who sit in front of you will need that type of back and forth, right? So it's going to vary anyway. Oh, I hope I answered that. Yes. I thought I saw a hand over here. Yes.
I'm wondering, you touched at the end about incorporating these ideas into science methods courses or math methods courses. Are you teaching a math methods course, and how are you incorporating them? And if not, how would you envision that?
Yes, so I did teach math methods last year to seniors. And one activity that we did, obviously Michigan State is not far from Chicago. I taught in Chicago. We took maps and did a map study. You can find all of this data online just about like the students who are highest performing, what part of the city are they in? And then comparing those maps to economic disparities and helping students to actually have access to data. I won't do a professional development at a school if they don't allow me to have access to some data or to collect my own data. Because folks, especially teachers, if we're being honest, we like a 1-2-3. We want a clean, you know, now tell me what to do, right? That's anti-intellectual, and that's part of the reason that folks don't take our profession serious, because we are too often wanting to get the best practice, even the language of best practice for who? And folks are sort of shifting that language to sort of think about context-based practice, right? What do I need to do for this group of kids? So just because I taught black kids before in Philadelphia doesn't mean that I know what the black kids in Chicago need. So this is where empathy becomes important, because I need to, it requires that there's an individual sort of relationship and connection that comes about in my daily interaction. So we have multiple interactions with kids over time. So in this course, again, I put data in front of students. We watched videos and had really candid conversations. And right around the time that the Baltimore uprising was happening, there was a video of a young man who, someone just video recorded them on their cell phone, and he talked about, these pigs are killing so-and-so. And he was actually pointing to, here are facts. And here's not, these are not isolated incidents. I'm pointing to a trend. So now we can't argue with trends, right? And you talk about triangulation. It's happened here, it's happened here. Social media is showing us that what's happened in my community is happening in communities everywhere. So now I need to ask some questions, and I need to resist, because what I've been told is not what's happening, right? So I showed this video, and I was a little nervous about showing the video because he was like hardcore and he was, you know, cursing and all that type of stuff. But for me, if my expectation for them as teachers going out is for them to engage the social context and to bring the social context into their classroom, I have to model that for them. So I took that video and I showed it to them, and I scrapped my lesson plan, you know, in that class, and we just sat an hour and responded to the video. And it was uncomfortable. I was the only black male in the class. It was all, you know, predominantly white women, right, that I was teaching. And to have that conversation was a little bit risky, because I didn't know, you know, which way it was gonna go, but I just thought it's important to put this in front of them and give them and trust them enough and trust myself enough that they can respond to this intelligently, particularly for making sense of, now, how does this influence your own developing teacher identity? How do you engage this type of experience? It can't be them over there and I'm over here, right? So I think it's putting data in front of them and exposure is really useful.
I work with bilingual students, and we do a lot of thinking around language. And I wanted to ask you, how does your work on empathy and your experience square with language use? With people wanting to change the way students sound, or with very deeply innate responses to different ways in which people sound?
Yeah.
So how do you deal with those biases that all of us have that seem to be very deep about language use, correctness, and the connection with intellectuality?
So, and this is where this work in critical race theory and my thoughts about race sort of give me a language and a way to name and recognize what that is. When I am trying to strip away your accent and the way you say stuff and the way you articulate yourself in the way that your family likely articulates love and support to you, that is part of the project of assimilation and trying to make you, for lack, trying to make you less of who you are. And there's all this work around the ways in which language is connected to identity, and when we do that to kids, we are telling them that they're not good enough, right? So I think this part of this is helping teachers to get a language and to be able to see. It's like, you know, you put your glasses on, you learn something, you're like, I see this completely different than I did before. And I think in a lot of ways, teachers don't understand how intricately language is connected to a student's self-concept and image of themselves, right? It's really important. For those of us who have the privilege of being in the academy and sitting and thinking and reading, we're able to name that type of stuff, but not enough of the time does our work sort of filter in the schools to help people to understand when you continuously tell a kid you're talking wrong, the types of messages that they're getting is, it could be any number of things. You don't like me. This is how my mom talks to me. So is she wrong? Will I ever fit in here? Do I belong here? Right? That's when the norm of a place is so clearly apparent that I don't fit in, it really makes it hard for me to function in that place. And you can have really good intentions, but that does nothing for making me feel good about being in the space. So I think in a lot of ways, teachers have to, this is, I think, part of it. we have an urban ed cohort at Michigan State, and those students have a pretty different experience than students in our mainstream program, which is like good but not good, because they don't get access to this rich literature. And it's integrated into their courses in a way that's very intentional and strategic if you have the urban sections of, you know, your math methods and your literacy course that doesn't get translated into the other courses. So I really just think exposure, particularly these intellectual perspectives that help you to see and name the ways in which these sort of actions strip away one's sort of cultural identity and healthy racial and ethnic identity development is important.
So I just have a question, because your sort of very first research question that you presented was about how early career teachers conceive of these importance. You kind of laid out your framework using Davis's ethical concern and perspective teaching. Did that sort of emerge from what you were hearing from teachers, or did you kind of like bring that framework in kind of prior to teachers?
I found that framework before talking to teachers. So I did a pilot study with these four early career teachers that was a pilot for the dissertation. And really what I wanted to know, so Davis has a empathy assessment tool where there are seven items for these four scales of empathy's multidimensionality. So I was able to give that scale to them. We were able to talk about, tell me what empathy is, where is it useful, you know, how do you see it manifesting itself in your regular life? Then I gave them that tool, which asked questions like, I am tenderhearted when I see someone in pain. Very concrete questions that they could rate themselves. And then I gave them a score, and then we had that conversation again, and their answers tended to change because they now had a more standard way of thinking about empathy, and then we had this conversation. So,
yeah. So then when you were talking about the benefits of empathy, you mentioned that these are things that teachers have already been doing, you're just sort of giving them a different way of looking at their own behaviors and actions in the classroom. Have you found that those teachers have kind of taken up that language of empathy and kind of, has it like spread sort of throughout their schools? Like how have they been able to sort of use sort of this, like these concepts that you have?
That's a good question. I haven't followed up to see necessarily how the folks that I've worked with. I know at the end, so the follow-up study was then to find a group of effective teachers, folks who were rated effective by administrators and students, and I did about over 500 hours of observations per teacher. And then I would do follow-up interviews. I would identify trends in behavior. So they would interact and I would record all of this data, and I would collect data over 5, 6, 7 visits, code the observations for trends, and then I would go and I would have conversations. Tell me about this. Why did you do this? What was your motivation? What was your thinking behind this? To sort of get at the cognitive sort of thought process. And then we would have conversations. And then by the end, what they would say is, I never thought about empathy in the ways that you, and I didn't use the language of empathy a lot in my conversations with them. It was really about their practice. Because at the end of the day, right, empathy is this sort of abstract concept, is sort of up here and high, and everybody thinks about it very differently. But the actual things that I observe you doing, the decisions that you actually make in practice, you only know why you do what it is that you do. And it's my work as an intellectual to make the connection. So folks just talked about their practice, but in looking at the trends across the teachers and being able to name this sort of cyclical process, they are able to say, this seems a little bit common sense, but when you have a name for a process, you can be much more intentional and strategic about enacting that process. And I think that that's what has been useful for them. But again, these are folks who are already really effective, and what they've learned to do is to adjust their practice in ways that caters to the needs of students. And ultimately, that's all that empathy is arguing. One teacher told me, so what you're saying, Dr. Warren, is that I need to not break up with my students. And so she sort of internalized this concept of empathy. If I want to be in a relationship with a partner, I have to make all sorts of adjustments and adaptations and compromises. But we sort of train teachers not to have to make those compromises, because you're the teacher, you manage this classroom, this is your stuff, be in control, right? Even the language of control is just so problematic, right? Especially when you talk about the legacy of you know, racism in this country, and you are preparing teachers to go and control kids, right? So when you walk into any charter school anywhere, everybody's walking in a line. But in these other schools, we don't have that same climate. So I think it's folks being able now to think more critically about their work than they had before. Whether or not they actually use the language of empathy, I don't know. That's really not as important to me as sort of being able to help them to see their work more clearly.
Yeah. So your very first sentence was about mutuality, and the conversation seems very one way. I mean, is there a place or a role for empathy from the students for the teacher?
I always get that question in every setting. It wouldn't have been right if I left without that question. My take is this. The short answer, sure. Students should have empathy for their teachers. But students are not responsible for grading themselves, for providing the learning experiences. What they bring to the table in some way impacts the learning experience. But my first principal said, oh, you're really smart. You went to the University of Illinois, but can you teach? And what her point was, at the end of the day, you are responsible for what happens here, and the power is in your hand to create an environment. So the conversations that I have with teachers is not, we don't enact classroom management or make moves in order to control kids. We make moves to create an environment that those kids feel safe and valued and affirmed. And so there are decisions that they're going to make, and there are decisions that you're going to make. You can't control the decisions that they make. You can only control the decisions that you make. And as the responsible adult, you have to be the one to respond in such a way that compels them to respond to you differently. And that's sort of the way that I see this. But it's important, I think, in modeling that sort of care and transparency, that students feel invited to then themselves be just as vulnerable. And part of that process is you have to keep showing up no matter how hard that is. So the only advice I give to a first-year teacher is just show up. Just keep coming back. Because in coming back, that sends a large enough message for a kid who's had 5 teachers in 2 years. Just coming back says, this person is different. Because I know I'm giving them hell. But they keep coming back, right? And then that compels them to respond to you differently.
Well, thank you so much for joining us.